Hey guys, it's Hina Sheth here at Rebalance Physical Therapy and Wellness in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, as well as on the main line in Narberth, Pennsylvania. And I am a orthopedic and pelvic floor physical therapist that specializes in treating spine, hip, and pelvic floor disorders. So today I want to talk to anyone of you who is suffering from a condition called cervical dystonia. So what is cervical dystonia? How does it affect people? And what can be done about it? So cervical dystonia is a condition where you might have spasming of certain muscles, particularly a muscle called the sternocleidomastoid, which is a muscle that actually starts right here, kind of behind the ear, okay? And it attaches to the jaw and it comes down in this kind of strip form in through here, and it attaches to the sternum as well as what's called the clavicle or the collarbone. And so oftentimes what we see is that one side, you have two of those muscles, one on this side and one on this side. And oftentimes what you find is one particular side will be really spasmed and tight. And so you might also see a posturing of the head in either a side bent in a rotated position, depending on which side of the neck is tight. And oftentimes cervical dystonia can be accompanied by, you know, all sorts of head and neck pains, tightness, spasming, headaches, and I'll show you why in just a second. But basically, if you do have cervical dystonia, several of my patients who have come in with this condition have told me all sorts of stories about how they feel that, you know, certain things can't be done to their head and neck because that's not good for the cervical dystonia, or certain strengthening that they do makes their cervical dystonia worse. And so there's all these theories out there on what can and can't be done. And what I have found in our practice is that most of these theories are, you know, they're theories that, oh, you shouldn't massage certain muscles, or you shouldn't, you know, take the spasming out of certain muscles, or you shouldn't strengthen in a certain way, or you shouldn't stretch this particular muscle. And I have found a lot of those things, at least in my practice, to be false, because I use all of these things on a lot of my patients and I see improvements and results with my patients with cervical dystonia. So again, if we go back to the symptoms of cervical dystonia, okay, you can see that I'm going to use the sternocleidomastoid as the particular muscle that we're talking about here. Okay, this is that muscle that again starts behind the ear and it comes down and it attaches to the sternum and the clavicle. And you can see these X's right over here are places where you can develop spasms in that muscle. And so when you develop spasms in that muscle, what can happen is that spasm basically doesn't allow, when something's really tight, you don't get good blood flow into that area. When you don't get good blood flow, you don't get good healing, because blood is what brings the nutrients and all that good stuff for things to heal. And so if you don't have good blood flow, then you're gonna have basically an irritated muscle that, again, you've got nerves that also go through this area, and the nerves is what gives you pain. And so what we often find is that when people start developing the spasmings in this area, it can actually cause lots of different types of symptoms. And the symptoms are in the red, or pain. Okay, you can have frontal headaches, you can have over the ear headaches, you can get headaches in the back. And oftentimes what I have also seen with this is other neck conditions can develop. You can get arthritic changes in the head and neck. You can get weakening of the muscles, because oftentimes I've seen people that get lots of Botox treatment into these muscles. And what we have found is sometimes excessive Botox treatment, and again, I'm not saying it's because of the Botox treatment, but sometimes what we've heard is possibly that the Botox has also caused weakening of some of the muscles that actually helps with stabilizing your head and neck. And so when that stability sometimes goes away, then you can develop other conditions that affect not only the musculature of the neck, but the joints of the neck. And when we're talking about the joints of the neck, you know, we're talking about these guys right here. So you've got 7 vertebrae in your neck. And again, when different muscles are spasming and they don't allow the neck to be in a good posture, then you're going to start seeing joint changes in through here. And again, if there's also weakening of the muscles that help to stabilize, meaning help to keep your neck strong when you're trying to maintain good posture and your head and neck upright, if those begin to weaken, then the combination of that can cause arthritic changes within the joints. And the reason why that happens is because there's a lot of shearing between the joints, and a lot of shearing causes friction, and friction wears down the cartilage or the tissue that cushions those joints between each other. And then again, down the line, you can develop all sorts of like pinched nerves and disc issue, herniated disc issues and things like that, that can also affect, you know, lots of other things, meaning you can develop weakness in the hand, you can develop pain in the back of the shoulder blades, all these types of things. And I've kind of seen this in different patients that I have treated over the last 20 years. So what can be done about cervical dystonia? Well, it is a fine combination and the right sequencing that needs to be done for patients that have this. So basically, at least in our practice, we address not only the muscles, but also what's called the fascia of the neck, meaning there's tissue that actually binds all of the muscle and the joints together. And it's kind of like this, you know, cobwebby material that is flexible, but it also keeps things compartmentalized in your body. And the neck definitely has fascia. Okay, there's fascia throughout your whole entire body. So we gotta address the fascia, we have to address the muscles, we have to address the joints, okay? There's joints underneath all of that muscle that helps your spine move. So we have to address the joints, make sure that any of the joints that are too stiff are actually, we improve the mobility or what's called the movement of those stiff joints. And then the joints that are moving too much, actually, that's where we actually need to add the strengthening piece. So these are the stabilizers that I was talking about. So oftentimes you'll get weakness in those stabilizers, but underneath all of that, there's also excessive movement in the joints, and that's where you can develop that arthritic change. So it needs to be a combination of all of these things that's very, very specific to you and what's going on with your head and neck in order for you to see improvements in the symptoms that cervical dystonia is possibly causing you. So, you know, basically who's going to be able to do this? So if you have a really good physical therapist that understands how all of these things are treated together, oftentimes you'll hear that they're manual physical therapists. Okay, but I want to take this a little bit further because I'm a manual physical therapist. And when I used to work in traditional physical therapy offices, there was only so much manual physical therapy I can do. So now at our clinic, you know, when we're treating patients, we treat them for an hour at a time, where a lot of the times we're doing a lot of the hands-on work, at least initially, to really get a lot of this soft tissue, fascia, muscle, joint, all of this improved. And then we slowly layer on the strengthening and the stretching that needs to be done. So finding a really good physical therapist in your area is going to be highly beneficial, especially somebody that understands cervical dystonia. However, if you live in and around the Philadelphia area or the surrounding suburbs where you can come see us, then I would highly recommend that you come and see us, especially if you've been suffering from this condition and you're finding that you're just not getting much help. Maybe physicians aren't giving you the right type of treatment that you need, or they have and some of it has failed. Maybe you've seen a chiropractor, but it was either too aggressive or you didn't see improvements. So this is where we kind of take over and start to help patients get better. Now, if you hop onto our website, it's rebalancept.com, rebalancept.com. Sorry, I may have even spelled that wrong, but it's rebalancept.com. We have lots of other helpful blog posts. We have newsletters that go out with helpful information, self-help tips. We also have lots of other YouTube videos that goes into more in depth about explaining about other neck conditions that you might be having. And so watch those. If you live in around this area and you're looking to come in to see us for treatment, you may even qualify for a free phone or in-person consultation with us. So I hope this video was helpful for many of you that might be having cervical dystonia. And I hope that you guys find the help that you need, and hopefully this video just adds a little bit more insight into what might be going on and what can help. So have a wonderful day.